So, welcome back. If you enjoyed Who Am I, I hope that you like this as well. This speech I am going to call consumption. I picked this topic because it is important that we understand what consumption means, because everything that manifests in our lives comes into reality because of the things we consume. When we are younger, we don't truly understand the power of consumption because it is never really taught to us as children. Growing up, I thought of consumption from a very limited perspective. This understanding was limited to eating, drinking, and that was pretty much it. I didn't realize it until I became more self-aware of how important this word truly is. I learned that anything that we absorb through our five senses is consumption, whether it be through feeling, seeing, hearing, smelling, tasting, or even through vibrational frequencies that can't be detected with our external senses. Developing an understanding for consumption did not happen right off the bat for me. Daily, most of us have so much going on in our lives. We wake up and some take showers, work out, eat breakfast. Some rush out the door while others stay at home. While we venture out through our day, we focus on work, family, friends, pursuing passion, or taking classes to further our education. Regardless of your path, we all tend to get caught up in the world around us and forget about what is most important to our overall health. Instead of paying attention to what we consume, we become consumed by our own realities. This can be very unhealthy on both a physical and mental level. It is hard not to fall into the groove because we tend to focus on and consume everything around us just to keep up with the speed of life. We fall into this routine because we focus on what is good for our careers, ultimately because our careers support our way of life. In this, we often forget about what is good for us. After a long day, many of us come home drained and exhausted, just happy to have made it through the day. At this time, all we want to do is eat and kind of just take a load off so we can relieve our minds of any stressors that we may have incurred. Using one's mind constantly for hours can be quite exhausting depending on their level of responsibilities. There are many cases where we have to just grab food on the go because our time may be limited. I know this because I travel a lot and often have to just grab what I can on the go because I'm out and about. This can make it hard to plan a diet and keep up with a healthy, balanced, nutritious plan. For those of us who have families, coming home can sometimes be like a circus between the kids running around playing, after-hour activities, making sure homework is done, and that everyone is fed and in bed at a decent hour can be very time-consuming. Oh yeah, let's not forget about our other children, our pets if you have them. After a long day, we come home, and the whole time we are consuming everything from the children being loud, whatever is on TV, and of course, whatever topics are up for discussion. I do not personally watch TV, but having a family, the TV is often on in the background. Occasionally, I just put my AirPods on and listen to a nice classical track, audiobook, or even listen to other self-help artists that are out there. I find that this is a very relaxing tool that helps me drown out any unnecessary commotion. We may not realize it at times, but our brains are always absorbing data from our senses. Take for instance, if you're just sitting in a room where somebody is watching a horror flick, even though you are not watching it, because you may be focused on something else, you are still absorbing the noise. Your subconscious is hearing everything that goes on around it all the time, especially while you are sleeping. With that being said, the subconscious is registering data that is absorbed through your five senses. Even if you are not directly involved, this can unknowingly create trauma that affects your well-being. Studies have shown that trauma is stored within the central nervous system and can lead to health conditions if they are not addressed properly. Imagine if you were a child and saw your friend get bit by a vicious dog in the hand. Even though the incident did not happen to you, it creates a traumatic event within your nervous system. This consumption creates a sort of disconnect in the neurological system that stems from a place of fear. You feared for your friend because your friend was obviously in pain. It is almost like you manifested their pain in your mind as a way to understand what they were going through, thus storing this trauma as your own. I spoke previously about the subconscious. The subconscious is, in my opinion, our sixth sense. Just like we have five senses that register through external receptacles, the subconscious registers through internal senses that are emotional feelings. This is important to understand because everything that we consume that are considered toxins to the body through our external receptacles can create a form of trauma within our bodies. So the next time you are feeling sad, down, depressed, or sick, understand that something that you have consumed is responsible. The body is an amazing, intelligent piece of organic matter that has a built-in self-healing property that can cure itself of pretty much any health condition. Unfortunately, it will not work properly if our bodies are clogged with toxins and traumas that stem from something that we consumed in some way. It is important to know that everything bad in your life in some way evolves from something that you consume. I ask that you take notice to these people out there that always seem to feel great and appear so happy. I guarantee you that all of them exercise and often try to eat healthy. A lot of it has to do with your diet because our bodies need proper nutrition to thrive. The genetic makeup of the things we consume internally through food makes us feel either sluggish or energetic and can also control our moods. For example, if you drink coffee, it makes you feel an instant hype and you are then ready and on the go. If you think that you need meat, think again. I recommend only consuming it in moderate amounts if you do. Anything in moderate amounts is not necessarily bad for us, but can often make us stronger. Take a look genetically to our closest living relative on the planet, the ape. The only thing that separates our DNA from the ape is one single chromosome. You see, the ape does not eat meat and still managed to stay strong, muscular, and healthy for many years. I focus on this because when I eat healthy and eliminate the things like alcohol, sugar, and other things that are bad for me, I noticed a complete boost in my energy levels. This energy is clean energy that allows me to work at my full potential without the burnouts of caffeine. To be honest, I want to get to the point in my life where I no longer have to go at somebody else's schedule. I want to go at my own schedule because I believe that is what it means to fully thrive. Starting with my diet, I have cut out a lot of bread, meat, sugar, and starches. I consume a lot of dark berries for polyphenol, which is good for the heart, and if combined with fiber and probiotics, cleans out your arteries of cholesterol, giving you a huge boost in clean energy. When combined, they create a high-octane liver and kidney that can flush toxins way more efficient. I'm not here to be your dietitian or nutritionist, but I am just pointing out the facts how important eating healthy is to your overall health. The things we listen to also play a huge role in our physical well-being. The frequency that music is created at, in many cases, can often amplify anxiety, which in turn can raise stress levels. Therefore, I rarely listen to music that is inappropriate or that has negative influence. Music can unknowingly tarnish one's thinking because the subconscious is known to store information fed by repetition. Just as a trail is forged in the forest due to heavy traffic, negativity is stored in our minds through repetition. When hearing certain messages or frequencies, it slowly tarnishes one's soul. However, when you listen to things like classical music, instrumentals, binary beats, motivational speakers, and educational content, it slowly makes us more intelligent. Many people prefer songs that exercise their emotions, such as that sad country song, because they can relate to it so well. Well, guess what? By doing that, you are practicing that emotion, giving it more power, so when you experience a sad event, it affects you more intensely, making it harder to get over the sadness or depression. Don't get me wrong, when there is a positive message attached to a sad, traumatic story, like found in many storytelling motivational speeches, it exercises one's ability to change a negative into a positive. There are some good songs out there, however, I'm not a fan of many singing artists these days. I prefer Peace and Quiet or the instrumentals of symphony. On occasions, I do listen to rock, hip-hop, heavy metal, or whatever, but it is very limited because I know that my mind and body is strong enough to flush negative data, but only if it is consumed moderately. The same rule applies to all consumption. Microdosing can keep your immune system and mental health strong. Just don't let it become a habit because it can eventually consume you. If you consume positive, inspirational, motivational, and educational content only, In place of using music that seems to help suppress the void of boredom in your life, you will start to notice a positive change in your outlook. I actually started practicing this after reading a book called Psycho-Cybernetics. I thought to myself, I'm going to change my paradigm by consuming nothing but positivity for 21 days. I forced myself to listen or watch things that had inspirational, motivational, or educational properties only. In this time, I use binary frequencies which help intensify the effects of my plan. Before I started this cycle, I was at the bottom of the barrel depressed, where I just didn't care anymore. All I wanted to do was smoke a joint, get high, and turn up the bottle to suppress the overwhelming suffering that I was feeling. After my 21-day plan, which has now become a part of my daily routine, I had successfully changed my paradigm. It was definitely tough making these kind of commitments, but my life has not been the same since. Between the 21-day habit-changing techniques, learning the Buddhist teachings, and a deep-level meditation that I was able to achieve with the assistance of binary frequencies, I had unlocked my true potential. I'm telling you this because once it is unlocked, there is no going back. I became more self-aware in 21 days than I did in my entire life before then. With my newfound awareness and understanding of all things, I was inspired to start creating content to help others achieve what I had achieved. I noticed that the more I created content to help others, the stronger my feelings of love and compassion grew within me. This is when I came across a book by Zig Ziglar, which explained to me exactly what I was feeling. He said something along the lines of, "In order to achieve your goals, you must first help others toward theirs. And the more love and compassion that you put out into the world, the more that comes back your way." This really hit home with me because I was experiencing this effect daily already. By doing this, it fulfilled me with a sense of purpose, life, and love that I had never thought possible. So that is why I do what I do. There is no financial gain that fuels my movement. I have connected with over 60,000 people through social media that follow me and often listen and engage with my content. The sole intent of my work is to help others and make the world a better place. It is only natural to assume that there is always a hidden agenda. I too hear people's messages and assume that I know of their intent, but I never judge because judging is a form of vanity. It is always important to pay attention to others' intent, because there are many sociopaths out there that honestly believe that they are more deserving and better than all others around them. I really enjoy sharing what I do with the world because hopefully it inspires someone somewhere to reach their true potential. I have had many people message me telling me how much they needed to hear the message that I spoke. They told me that they were stuck and that my speech helped them through a hard situation. Now they felt ready to go and take on the world. This to me is more valuable than any amount of money. This kind of gratitude alone increases my drive, inspiring me to create more content. So by helping them, in a way, it helped me toward my true purpose. I am going to be successful regardless because I am not driven by financial wealth. I don't need anything from anyone except support to help get my message to the right people. Although the speech may not be for you, there is someone in your circle that may be suffering. You may have even tried to reach out to them, but had little results. I know I have talked to family and friends who were obviously suffering, but they were not subjective to my opinion or my truth. Maybe they weren't ready or simply didn't want to hear it from a loved one. I understand that there are 16 different personality traits, and I also am aware that out of the millions of people that I reach each month with my content, only about 6% may be subjective to hearing the truth from an outside source. One lesson that I learned on my path to reach a shunyata bodhi state, which in Sanskrit means I found the emptiness that is required to be released from all suffering in order to reach a deep enlightened state. It is important that before you try to reach such states, you detox your mind and body of all impurities. Otherwise, you will never truly reach Dharma, because the toxins and traumas that cause you to suffer will prevent the emptiness required to reach such states. The key is to focus on what we consume by analyzing all that we absorb through our sensible sensations. Next, you must address any traumas by finding a positive lesson within each one. Trust me. No matter what caused it, there is some sort of positive outcome. If you can't seem to find this understanding, it may be because you were attached to the emotion that stems from a victim mentality, or unknowingly you are addicted to self-pity. By acknowledging the positive outcome each time the thought comes to mind, you will slowly find understanding until it becomes a part of your purpose that drives you. An example of this is when I had to take someone's life to save my own. Although this crippled me for many years, I now understand by doing so, it made me more resilient and has allowed me the privilege to be here and be a good father to my children. There is no greater feeling in life than to create another life and teach them to thrive. The things we feed our body through diet are of the utmost importance. The need to feed is amplified by trauma and stress, so therefore many people eat out of suffering. When the subconscious is suffering, it will seek to be fulfilled. So when you are hungry, it relies on the conscious decision that is chemically driven to fill the void. If the connection between the subconscious and conscious mind are blocked due to toxins or traumas, one's willpower to choose wisely weakens greatly. I get that it is hard to stop eating unhealthy foods in an instant, so I suggest only eating half a portion, but instead of drinking something with sugar, add about 8 to 12 or more ounces of water instead. What you will notice after 15 minutes or so, the hunger will subside. Overeating is a form of suffering, and quite frankly, the concept of eating 3 full meals a day to me is ridiculous. The human being can go about 30 days without food as long as they are drinking plenty of water. One can get the daily recommended nutrition from a single meal alone, so 300 calories is not meant to be consumed in one sitting. It is meant to be broken down and consumed little by little throughout the day. One tends to seek such cravings such as unhealthy foods because of suffering caused by stressors or trauma. Some helpful tools that will help you understand these catalysts are learning the Buddhist teachings, speaking with NLP practitioners, visiting a Reiki healer, learning self-hypnosis, or even visiting a professional hypnotherapist. These will all help you find understanding, but the most important part is you have to be subjective. For now, this is a technique that you can try. Close your eyes in a place of solitude, preferably a quiet place where you have no distractions. Focus on where you are feeling discomfort. If you do not feel anything, just relax a bit until you feel it. It could be an area of discomfort, a cramp, an itch, who knows. This is a sign that your body is trying to tell you something. Once you acknowledge the area, think deeply of the position. Give it a color, a shape, a smell, or even a number. With this information, let it form an image in your head. But do not overthink it, just go with the first things that come to mind. The idea is to give the potentially affected nerve area that is holding on to the trauma a physical description. We cannot consciously fix traumas that are stored within the nerve system. They must be addressed through the subconscious. The subconscious does not speak the same language as the conscious mind, but it does relate to emotions that are attached to perceived physical attributes. This exercise teaches the subconscious mind how to self-repair its neurological system. The next part of this exercise is to take a deep breath in and imagine that the physical properties that you have created in this area of discomfort are filling with air each new breath you take. In your mind, take notice to this particular area, which now appears as a spherical ball or as a 3D image, now has a new dimension that includes color, shapes, sizes, and even smell. Every thought that comes to mind while focusing on this area, let it become a part of your creation. Once you see it clearly, imagine while exhaling that all aspects of this new created property are being released into the air as you breathe out. All of the colors, numbers, shapes, smells that create this image that were created within the area of discomfort are now leaving your body and your mind. Do this several times, each time creating a new image. This technique can also be used for things like removing hunger. If all of this seems questionable, I challenge you for 21 days, practice everything that I spoke about above. Make the first thing you do in the morning while going to work, listen to some motivational or inspirational content. There is plenty to be found on YouTube. Change your diet by cutting your sugar intake in half and drinking double the amount of water that you normally drink. Stop eating heavy carbs like bread and eat more dark berries and food high in fiber and probiotics. Lastly, exercise 3 times a week for more than 30 minutes each time. I recommend getting your heart rate up to an average athletic range for your age limit at least 3 times each workout session. If you can commit to something like this just once in your life will never be the same again. Many people will not commit to things that seem hard. That is why there are so many people that are limited in life. You are the creator of your destiny, so only you can change your paradigm, but you must first commit to it. Thanks for listening, and I hope you enjoyed part two of my new audio series, Who Am I? If you made it through the whole track, comment, I am the one, in the section below, and share with someone that you think that might need to hear this, because a message given to someone at the right time shows a simple act of kindness